you investigated a little earlier this evening, do you feel that he should stop fighting given the performances that he's had in his last fights?
Who am I to say that? Like, you know, like, Fedor is Fedor. Fedor can do whatever Fedor wants. Do I think I'm going to win? Yeah, absolutely. Do I think I'm a dangerous fight for Fedor? Absolutely. Do I think that, I think at this point, beating Fedor, or Fedor beating me, I think kind of revalidates him. I think I'm pretty damn solid. And especially with the work I've been able to get in, with my coaches, with my training team, I think I'm pretty damn good. I always say, man, I can beat anybody in the world on any given day. I can be one of the best in the world, if not the best. So, you know, for Fedor to come in and try it out, that shows he's a lifelong competitor, and that he's never satisfied. He wants more. So who am I to say he should quit?
On top of that too, when you make up the criticisms of his past competition, many bring that up, that the last guys he's fought at his weight class at heavyweight haven't been the elite. What do you make of all that criticism? And do
you agree? You know, I don't know. I feel like a real dark cloud of finesse over me right now. I don't know, man. I don't put time into that. I don't have an opinion on him. Like, people want to say, the only person I've ever heard say that is Chael, and he's just tongue in cheek, just dicking around with people. So like, I don't care. I wasn't involved in a pride era. I'm involved in my era. I'm drug free. I'm sure Fedor is drug free. So the fact that his people that were the people he beat, maybe he was on steroids, maybe they're on steroids, maybe they weren't, maybe they were the best or not the best past the prime. I don't care. I care. February 18th, I'm going to go in there and I'm going to punch Fedor in his face. And Fedor's going to punch me in my face. And hopefully I can avoid more than I give. That's all I can do.
Hey, Dan, full contact fighter. I was wondering, I mean, Fedor is Fedor because of his power, because he's not just a great sambo champion, because he's got that overhand, right? Can you really prepare for that in your camp?
Absolutely. Yes, I can prepare for that for certain. The thing that is the challenge is he jumps in there. He's got a tremendous amount of go. So he closes distance very quickly. He jumps into his left hook. He turns out to a double underbody lock. And is very good at getting people to the ground off that double body lock, whether it's a pull.
His right hand turns into a shot, next thing you know.
For
kind
sure.
of like Mayweather.
Yeah. So if you play passive waiting for the overhand right, then all of a sudden he's on your legs. If you play passive on the left hook where he jumps into it and he's trying to play up here, then all of a sudden he's on your body lock. You play the body lock and you land on the hook. So he's great at what he does, and he always has been. That's why he's favored. But honestly, like I hear he's strong, I hear he's powerful, but you know, so am I. And I throw straight down the pipe. So if anything kind of comes looping around, I'm sure they know that I'm going to be throwing straight down the pipe as a counter. And Henry Hoof's the best driving coach in the country, or in the world. And I feel that we're prepared for that.
With everything in the gym.
Yep, I'm a Henry guy, man. That's Henry's my striking coach. Coach Greg is my wrestling coach. Chris Seidel's my mentor. So I do a lot of traveling back and forth and get as much as I can between the three of those. But my team, Team Two-Ton, which is Charles Stanback and Ed Jones, I call him Butter. There's nobody in the world I've ever met that has refrigerator strength like that. So refrigerator strength, you can pick up refrigerator and carry the block. They're strong. Charles is a very strong Greco guy. So as soon as they get their hands on me, I know I'm in trouble and there's a 5-point throw coming. So I've been prepared for it. I got Coach Tom Erickson, Big Cat, who always advises me and helps me out along the way. So I feel like the team I put together has kind of prepared me for this moment. And I've had a history of not succeeding at my biggest opportunities, and I plan on changing that.
What would a win over Fedor mean to you?
It means I can pay.
How many fights did you sign for with Bellator?
Four or five deals.
Yeah. And so the question would be, though, after Fedor, would everybody else be something of a letdown fight, or would you just at that point feel like the title fight would be the next best thing?
Well, I mean, really, I don't think there's such a thing as a letdown fight. Fedor's a huge fighter, right? But I think that once you have that perspective, or you allow yourself to have that perspective of a letdown fight, that's when you get seriously hurt for the rest of your life. And that can easily happen. For example, look at Karatanov, right? Karatanov, I'm assuming, did not take did very seriously. Right? Came in there, wasn't totally lubed up. Maybe it was the walkout, because it takes such a long time for Bellator for the original walkout to show the stage and everything else. Maybe it was. And that happens. And that was a brutal knockout. So I think that if you allow yourself to have that mentality, that's when bad things happen. So I don't think I've ever run into that.
Matt, between this fight this weekend and your fight with Fedor, Bellator probably has the two biggest fights of the year, at least the first 2 months. Mm-hmm. How do you see the progress going with Bellator, and do you like where it's going?
You know, I'm very happy with what Bellator is doing, primarily because they're not just throwing money and chasing any free agent. I think they're being very selective about who they pick. I think they're paying attention to who has a fan base, a good following, who affects ratings, what their placements have always been on cards, and what they've been able to do. And I think they've made very, very intelligent choices. And I'm really happy with the way they treat us. Like it's a totally different world. Like not even the perks. It's just the conversation. Like you get to know everybody involved, and you're not just like if you have something to say. Like even if they're just patronizing, you'd be like, oh yeah, right on, man. That sounds great. But it was at least like an entertaining. You're like, oh right on. I guess we could do this and this, and then they could go away and never think about it again. But at least at the moment, you don't feel like you're being demeaned and just like, yeah, right on, dude. Kind of the situation.
What do you think it'll take for Bellator to make that big leap to get on par with the UFC?
You know, man, I don't know. Well, it's the marketing machine, right? It's the PR, it's the money that's been put into the game, right? And the UFC was a groundbreaker, right? Well, next to Pride, but... So it'll probably take time. And I think they're doing the right things. I think Mr. Coker's production is fantastic. I like the walkouts, I like the scenery, I like the panache, the funk of it, you know? It's pretty dope. You know, like I said, it's probably just time, putting on good shows. I think it really speaks really well for Bellator now that Benson came over, fought his ass off at 170 but didn't win that fight. Fought his ass off against 135 against Michael Chandler and didn't win that fight. I think that shows, like, hey, man, our top talent is just as good as anybody else's top talent. And I think that, you know, Phil Davis coming over and winning that, I think that it's good. I think they're kind of revamping everything they got to get done. But I think there'll be some hell fights. It's just time.
Matt, you mentioned Andrei Arlovsky, and especially with Freddie Roach behind him, people don't realize, but he was an elite-level boxer in MMA. Are you going to try to stay outside of the pocket with Fedor, or are you going to try to kind of stay away from his power? What's your strategy in the stand-up?
Well, I don't go nibble to nibble with too many people. I'm not a wrestler. It's not my forte. I'm long. I'm straight. I throw straight punches. I'm long. I throw straight punches. I keep my distance anyways. I feel like I'm the master of my area, my territory. So if Fedor wants to come in that area, which he won't have to touch me, he'll have to eat a couple. I mean, he may get his hands on me. He may get me to the ground. He may throw his punches and bunches on me. But there'll be some counters left in there.
Is that the most dangerous thing? I talked to Bas Rutten once about fighting him and what you would be most scared of, and he said being on bottom and the ground and pound, having Fedor raining down on you.
Fedor's ground and pound is legendary, and he's to the point where he has such good body control that he's reckless with it, which I think is what Dan Henderson was able to capitalize on, where he didn't feel like he had to control it because his hips are so heavy, and Dan just kind of knee bumped him over with a little bit of an underhook and came up and threw
got under that armhook.
Yeah.
Punch, yeah.
I think that Fedor is so good at what he does. He has so much power, and he's so comfortable throwing it, that being on underneath him is not where I want to be.
Matt, is he the greatest of all time?
In my opinion.
What's your favorite Fedor fight?
That's difficult. You know, you could say the Crow Cops, right? You could say even the Kevin Randall, because when he got dumped on his head to keep his composure to roll back under to gain top position eventually and defense like that. I mean, that was remarkable. It was amazing. Just like situations he's been in. The Nogueira fans. I mean, he just finds a way to win all the time. I mean, he's so stoked. He keeps his head about him at all times. You don't ever see him lose his cool and get flustered and do something stupid. That's amazing.
Randall Man actually came in and knocked him out with that slam, then woke him back up when he hit him.
I would believe it. I mean, really, I saw shades of that slam and his composure in Benson when Benson got dumped in his head by Michael Chandler and then sat up for a second and rolled back under for a single.
It's a scary looking slam.
Oh, for certain. And it shows how much you got.
Can you talk a little bit about the state of the heavyweight division right now? Obviously, a lot of American bigger athletes tend to go to baseball, football and basketball and all that as well. What do you think it's going to take to motivate some, maybe some more American heavyweights to get in? And the international scene, I mean, how is that impacting the heavyweights? Because we're seeing a lot more older heavyweights, not as many younger ones.
Well, I think, A, money. Money has to change, right? Because somebody actually considered doing MMA versus football or hockey or whatever, money's going to change. So I think that's a primary concern. I think the second is ego. I think a lot of dudes that I know that play pro ball or even wrestlers can't handle getting their ass beat in front of 5 billion people, plus mom, grandma, dad, uncles, you know, your friends on your block come home and be like, dude, you got fucked up, you know, like and you got me all lumped up and you got an eye with a testicle on it. I mean, it's just a rough life. So if a lot of people, I don't think a lot of people's egos can handle that. I think that's probably one of the biggest things. So it's more of like a self-check and a gut check, that if you can handle that, handle getting your ass, because eventually it's going to happen, right? I mean, you're going to get smoked badly in front of the world, and it's going to be on da-da-da, you know. So it's I think if they can handle that, so I think it's money, and I think it's a self-check with ego.
Are you thinking about maybe going over to Ryzen maybe and participating there? I know Kimbo has been over there, and there's plenty of heavyweights over there.
I get paid by Bellator, so I'm happy with Bellator. If we have a conversation that says, hey, we're cool with this, and there's equal money over here or greater money over there, well, then I'll have a conversation.
And then Chael had mentioned the fact that you've basically signed a blank contract for Fedor. And, you know, did you have any inklings that it was going to be Fedor once you...
I thought it was going to be Rampage. And originally, I was like, well, it's going to be... Because I heard that they were having a really difficult time signing Fedor. So I thought it was going to be Rampage or maybe even Krokop or Karatanov. And Karatanov lost, so I kind of wiped him out of the picture. And then I was quite certain it was going to be Rampage. And it was like, here, were you cool signing this out without a name on it, without seeing the monies? And I said, is it this month? There were 2 weeks left in a month. Is it this month? And they said, no, it's not. I said, okay. I was like, well, is the fight worth my time? It's not. I promise you it's worth your time. Sure, what the hell? I mean, I'm here to compete, so let's get down.
At what point did you know it was Fedor? Was it right when you walked out? Or?
But when I saw the glorious sweater of absence.
What do you tell Fedor if he's watching?
I hope you have a great camp. Can't wait to punch you in your face.
You stated your respect for Fedor already. It sounds like you're treating this as if it was, you know, him and his A-plus game, but have you looked at his last couple fights and seen any tendencies? You know, it looks like he's kind of almost abandoned his grappling, which is his biggest strength in the Maldonado fight. He just struck the whole time. What have you seen that you can capitalize on with your game?
I have not watched any of his... I have not watched any of his fights recently at all, because I kind of feel that those are misnomers. I think they're one-offs. They were ring rust. So I've seen Fedor for a long period of time. I know what Fedor does. Everybody knows what Fedor does. It's what Fedor's awesome. He does whatever he does, and everybody still falls victim to it. I am 100%. I mean, I'm obviously I'm still preparing and practicing for Greco locks, back trips, body weight drops, anything else. I'm expecting nasty ground and pound. I'm expecting we're starting in against the best grapplers I can find down in Florida, anywhere else. I'm starting in the deepest arm bars I can get. I'm starting in Kimura positions. I'm starting in anybody I grapple with. I'm like, look, end up in any kind of shoulder lock, any kind of arm bar. I'm looking for that. Any kind of crafty setup that I don't see coming, I'm looking for it. That's what Fedor holds me. So, like, whether it's belly up, belly down, like, tripping around, I don't care if you do a cartwheel and end up in it. So I'm preparing for the worst.
One question for you. It's Tito's last fight. You know, what has Tito meant to you? I mean, you're a fighter. This guy's been around forever. You know, if you just have any comment on him and as he says goodbye.
You know, when I was doing the Mitrione Minute, I had a really good time poking fun at Tito. I'd always make some kind of Tito joke or whatever. But the reason why I did that is because Tito's a legend, you know, and he made a massive difference in the sport. From the time he came in, his personality, his persona, and his attitude, unapologetically, the way he is, and it was, it's been cool for me to come in there out of nowhere, right? Like no fights, nothing else. We're an Ultimate Fighter being a douchebag on Ultimate Fighter, and then started poking fun at Tito, just to get his eye, just get some attention out of it. And then when I finally met him, I never met him before. When I finally met him, we almost got in that scrap at the summit. And then after I lost to Chad Congo, I finally had we were at the same club that night. I was all lumped up, my face all bleeding and stuff. And I was like, hey man, now that I have a chance to talk to you, I'll just be a dick. You know, just kind of like, I kind of pulled one of your cards and just kind of stealing some thunder and whatever else. And he's been cool to me ever since. Like, even when I was in London for my fight against Ali Thompson, my son was with me because we were going to go on a vacation afterwards. And I was like, well, I don't really know what to do with Jacob. And Tito was like, he's like, leave him with me. He's like, let me chill with him. He's like, my name's Jacob too. I started talking to Jake about everything under the sun. And he's a damn good dude. Like, I think like he's not chill. He's not eloquent with words and on the mic and anything else. But Tito's a legend. He helped build the sport. And the fact that it's his last fight, I really hope he does his most boxing.
Matt, what do you think about a fighters union?
I think everyone knows I'm a big fan of the fighters union. Right? I think as long as it's done properly, I think the fact that there are three split factions, I think is highly unfortunate that people can't put their egos aside and be like, let's get the common good here, let's work for these goals, let's have everybody that can be possibly informed, be as informed as this, say, look, these are the top five things that we have to do, top seven things that we have to do, then you focus on those things, and afterwards, after we get everybody to make a vote, and make everything work, now we can bicker in a jackal position about, well, I did this, and I did that, and I want to be this. I couldn't care less who's in power for whatever, but everybody's ego is affecting the greater good.
What's the number one reason for it? Is it for guys to retire? Is it to protect guys? Like, what specifically?
I think it's protection. What are you talking about? The ego jockeying?
No. The reason for a union in general. You guys have been doing that
for
so long.
Well, yeah, man. I mean, it's that we've been taken advantage of willingly because I don't think many of us were educated enough on the finer aspects of a business, you know, or being an athlete. And I think that we were taken advantage of for a long time. I think that we were naive about a whole lot. I think that we were so afraid of either being cut or being blackballed or getting really bad fights or whatever, or being, you fight four times last year, but now you split out, you're going to fight once this year, it's going to be at the end of the year. Kind of a situation where you have to scrap the cash.